you are Lord. So God, we just ask that you prepare our ears, hearts, and minds this morning, as well as our hearts as we prepare to sing praises to you and worship your word. God, we thank you, ask that you bless this time we have together. We thank you and love you, ask that you help us to love you more. In your Son's holy name we ask these things. Change that. Just take a breather. It's all good. Thank you. thankful, Lord, that we can come to you in times of need, in times of rejoicing. God, we not always put you first as we are sinful beings, but God, you have made a new creation in us. God, we're just thankful for your grace, for your mercy, and God, that that and help us to renew our minds each day. And God, we just ask you to continue to refine your people. We thank you and we ask this in your Son's holy name. Amen.
Amen. Well, good morning, church. Can everyone hear me okay? All right, good morning. I just want to read out the Psalms really quick. In Psalms 5 verses 1 and 2 says, 9 and 2, I will praise you, O Lord, with all my heart, and I will tell of all the wonders that you have done. I will be glad and rejoice in you, and I will sing praises to your name, O Most High. Amen. And that's why we gather this morning. Welcome to the Falls Church. For those of you that are new, we just want to extend a heartfelt welcome to you. My name is Sam. I get to serve here at the Falls Church, and just usually I like to take this time to bring you up to date on events that are coming up here in the next month or so at the Falls Church. The biggest thing that we have is our groups are starting to gather and form together after the holiday season. If you are looking to get plugged in and start fellowshipping and grow together in discipleship groups, please reach out to Ryan or myself or Jake. We're going to start really being intentional on splitting off into smaller groups where we could actually do life together and grow in our knowledge of Jesus Christ. We desire that. There are several groups as well for the women. Please reach out to Katie. And are you still leading your group? Just come up and we'll get you plugged in with the right leader. So. And I know Ryan has his group that meets up on Thursdays as well. But we do want to bring your, so if you're a member of this church, we just wanted to make you aware of different ways that you can give. We can give online. You can just go to thefalls.church on your phone, and there's a giving option there. You can also give in the offering box that's in the back. It's marked offering. And right now is the two primary ways to give, so that's the way that we honor the Lord with our giving. Once again, if you call this place your home and you want to worship in giving, that is the two options that we have right now. With that, we believe in fellowship and being living in community, so we want to take this time to just meet and greet your neighbor and just give them a warm welcome. And we'll get back together and Ryan will deliver the sermon for today.
Tomorrow we won't let go. Your presence. every door, write it on every wall, sing it in every room. Open up every door, write it on every wall, sing it in every room, Jesus, yeah. Open up every door, write it on every wall, sing it in every room, Jesus. As for me and my house, we will serve the Lord. We will sing of your love forevermore.
Tries to roll over my bones, when sorrow comes to steal joy I own, when brokenness and pain is all I know, I won't be shaken, I won't be shaken.
Well, I guess I will just start talking then, since it's not playing the sound. Can y'all hear me okay?
Yes.
Good morning.
Good morning.
Oh, that's so weak. You know, I'm like a robot. Good morning, church.
Good morning.
Oh, there we go. Well, it's good to be with you. If you are watching online, thank you for joining us. If you are visiting this morning, we're glad to have you with us. little warmer this week than last week. That's a praise report, right? Count your blessings.
Last week was, oh, whoa, there I am. Okay. I don't need to shout anymore. Thank you. And we started last week with a dad joke, and I got mixed reviews on it. Some people thought it was really good, and other people said, hey, that was lame, don't do that again. And to them, I'm going to try again. Okay, and we're going to do this as long as it's cold. Okay, so we might be doing this a while. So here's the joke for this morning. If you don't like it, take it up with the internet. This is where I found it. During the winter months, how can you tell someone is upset with you? Because they give you the cold shoulder. Use that one this week, and people will love you for it. There's no tomatoes. It's not tomato season, so we're good. So we're in the middle of a series where we're working through joy. And really, this was birthed out of, obviously, in Luke chapter 2, we have the angels that show up to the shepherds, and they said, hey, we have good news of great joy for you. And this is not just for you, but it's for all the people, right? And however, when we're in the holiday season and the New Year's beginning, can we agree that, like, we all feel like there's a lot tugging on us, right? Like, sometimes there's a lot of things that can steal your joy, right? That can get you distracted. It can be expectations with a spouse or with family members that, you know, are estranged. It can be, you know, finances. It can be health. It can be any number of things. And you know, as a believer, we trust that God is good and that God is sovereign, but we also want to control, in a sense, like what we can control, right? Or tend to that which we have the ability to impact. And we leave the rest in God's hands and trust him with that. And so as we process that, we then also need to take into account Jesus' words when he was in the Olivet Discourse, which is basically like, hey, this is the last little conversation he's having with his inner group before he actually gets, you know, fully betrayed and goes to the cross and all that. He tells his disciples, I would like you to abide in my love. Abide in my love. And I get this love from the Father. And it is, what I want for you, though, is if you really love me, you'll do what I say. He says you'll keep my commandments. And he says, I don't want to think about it conditionally, but the way it's spoken is kind of like a sequence of events. As you receive the Father's love and as you walk in obedience, I will abide in you. And then the what it says in verse 11 is, then I will take my joy that is in me and give it to you. And Jesus then, it's almost like he's wishing and praying, and my prayer, my hope for you is that your joy will be full and complete. This is John chapter 15, verse 11. So really with that is the premise for our series. We're now working through, okay, what are all these different facets of joy? And I want to read this psalm with me. And this psalm is on the front of your outline, and we're going to pull it up here. But this psalm is all about loving the Lord's ways. And think about this for a minute. Sometimes when we think about that word where Jesus used my commandments, is there anything inside anyone that's like, don't tell me what to do, right? Like a command, ooh. Right? Like that can be our posture sometimes, right? Is, oh, no one likes to be commanded, right? But Jesus is saying, hey, keep my commandments. Keep the Father's commandments. And perhaps a better way to think about this is the Lord's directives, like his instructions. The way that he prescribed his creation is, if you walk in these ways, this will be to your benefit because it will produce joy in your life. And said another way, if you don't walk in these ways, it will produce peril in your life and in the life to come. So read this with me. This is from the psalmist in Psalm chapter 19, verses 7 through 11. This is what the psalmist says. He says, the law of the Lord is perfect. You might want to say the Lord's ways are perfect. They reviving the soul. The testimony of the Lord is sure, making wise the simple. The precepts of the Lord are right, rejoicing the heart. The commandment of the Lord is pure, enlightening the eyes. The fear of the Lord is clean, enduring forever. The rules of the Lord are true and righteous altogether. They are more to be desired than gold, even much fine gold, and sweeter also than honey and drippings of the honeycomb, the most delicious food. Moreover, by them your servant is warned, and in keeping them, there is great reward. So if we believe that, let's go to the Lord this morning in prayer and just ask that he would give us that heart posture towards his ways. Father in heaven, we come before you this morning and we thank you that we can gather and fellowship in the name of Jesus Christ, our Lord, who we come under, and our Savior, who redeems us when we don't deserve it. We invite your Holy Spirit to lead us and guide us, convict us, encourage us, and instruct us this morning, that we may individually and collectively walk in your ways to your glory and to our filling of joy. And we thank you for this. In Jesus' name, amen. So I got a couple of illustrations I want to start with to kind of frame out this message. When we think about obedience and we think about commandments and we think about laws and all that sort of stuff, like I touched on, we can think about this in a, hey, thou shalt not sort of way. And then we might even get a little resistant, like, don't tell me what to do. But the truth is, if we have a right understanding of God and we understand his nature, that should lead to a trust and a love and an affection and a desire to live according to God's precepts. See, there's two things. There's one is knowing what to do. And then the second is, but I trust you enough to actually live it out, right? To reorient my life according to what you've said. And the premise for this morning is that if we adopt that, we will walk in the joy of the Lord. So I was running this last week. I'm like the only crazy person that's out there running when it's like 7 degrees. And I'm like got my, you know, my tights on and my pants over, right? So I can like stay warm. And I got like a t-shirt and a sweatshirt and like a windbreaker. And then I'm wearing like this like ski mask that only shows my eyes. And I'm out there running and it's like windy, like 20 miles an hour. And I'm thinking to myself, I need a treadmill, right? But nevertheless, I'm out there running and I've got 3 dogs. And guess what? Dogs need exercise too. So I'm out there running. I got 2 of the dogs. One's too old to run now. The other one kind of limps along. I'm out there with the German Shepherd and our little Shih Tzu. And the German Shepherd, I basically inherited from my father about like 5 years ago or so, because she was a bit too much for him to care for. And we had some space and we had a yard. And we're like, hey, she's a good dog. Well, when we got her, we realized she didn't actually even know her name. Like she'd never been trained. So we sent her off to training and she came back like a totally different dog, like because now she understood what we were saying, because before that she would never listen. But the problem is she didn't listen because to her it probably just wah, 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 right? It wasn't her heart that was the problem. It was that she didn't understand. And once she understood commands, she was actually eager to walk in those for the most part. Not always, right? So anyway, back to this. I'm out on my run, and I run out on this street, and I'm thinking, no one's crazy enough to be out here driving. I'm the only fool that's out here running. And I look behind me, and there's this car coming down the road. And I'm like, Sadie! Sadie! And I'm yelling at her, and I'm like, get out of the way! Do dogs know get out of the way? Like, what that means? Well, this guy, I don't know what he's doing, but he's flying down. My dad's listening to this. He's going to freak out after this. Okay, so this car is flying down the road and I'm there and I turn around and I'm like, ah, right? And he like slams on the brake when he was like this far from my dad's dog, like almost ran it over. And it was just making me think, I'm like, we can yell and we can scream and we can give commands, but if the person doesn't really understand or the dog doesn't really understand, it kind of doesn't matter, right? You put yourself in peril. And so it's not that she was trying to disobey. She didn't know what to do, right? And that was really maybe my fault for putting her in that situation. Fortunately, we have a God who doesn't put us in that situation. He gives us very clear instruction on what it is that we are to like refrain from and what it is that we are to pursue, because he loves us and he designed it that way and he cares for us. Amen? Right? One other illustration before we jump in this. How many of you have ever I'm sure everyone went to high school or college, right? Did you ever have professors or teachers where they would give you a test and they didn't give you a study guide? Did that tick anyone else off, right? It's like, here, read these 5 books and I'm gonna lecture for weeks and weeks and then I just want you to know what I'm gonna test you on. And I'm thinking to myself, if this is really important, why don't you let me know the things that I actually need to know so I can study those and learn those and then prove to you back that I paid attention to that which you told me to focus on, right? And again, going back to God, I think that he's that good professor. He's that good teacher. He literally doesn't leave us to walk in darkness. He's not that one that's like, I gotcha. He's like, no, don't do this stuff. It'll lead to death. Do this stuff. It'll lead to life. And I want you, Jesus, I want you to have my joy in you. So I'm telling you how you ought to live. And so there are a million different things that God basically told us to do and not to do. When we look at scripture, pursue wisdom, right? Right understanding, refrain from all this sort of stuff. But it can all be boiled down into basically two commandments. Jesus said this: love the Lord your God with all your heart, soul, mind, and strength, right? And love what? Love your neighbor as yourself. And if we keep that as the focal point, everything else will come into focus. So with that being said, this is going to be basically a two-week message. We're going to go through 3 points today of things that I believe we as Christians, as the church, maybe we need like a little bit of a checkup, and we need to go, you know what? I just want to make sure that I'm focusing on those most important things, the things that the teacher, Jesus was called a rabbi, right? He said, hey, these are the things that if you want to have fullness of life, focus on such things. Make it your heart's pursuit, okay? And as we go through this, I want you to do maybe some personal inventory. Don't just have me up here babbling, right? Do business with God. God, like, man, is this something that I have an opportunity to grow in? And if yes, Holy Spirit, help me to not just have this go in one ear and out the other, but cement it in my heart and shift my very being, that I may be full of your joy and living the way you instructed me. Is that fair? So point number one is, we as believers, if we want fullness of joy that Jesus wants for us, we need to pursue God. And it's not just that we pursue God, it's that we pursue God above all else. There's other things we're allowed to pursue. We can pursue having a family, we can pursue a career, we can pursue all this sort of stuff. But the number one thing, if we want our life oriented correctly, if we want the fullness of life that God offers us, the fullness of joy, this has to be our plumb line. This has to be like if we set in our GPS coordinates, right, we're typing in the address, this is first and foremost our pursuit. And if we're honest with ourselves, and I'll put both hands up, every single week, I need to be reminded of this, right? I will focus on comfort. I will focus on pleasure. I will focus on academics instead of relationship. I will, whatever it is, making money. All of us will focus on these things. And Jesus says, none of those things are necessarily bad. They're all gifts from God. But if they take that priority, Jesus said, thou shalt have no other, what, gods or idols before him. He didn't say that we can't have other things that are important to us. In fact, many of the things that he gave us, they're gifts when they're in their proper spot. I'm assuming everyone here, if you're in church, you believe God exists. Okay, that's an assumption. Good, so do the demons. James chapter 2:19, the demons believe and they shudder. We know in Romans chapter 1, Paul says that God has written on man's heart that he's true. But not everyone pursues him just because they believe in him. And that's the point of this, right? Like, pursuing God is different than believing in God. And so I want you to ask yourself a question, right? You got a listener guide there. Hopefully you have a pen. Like, if you were to give yourself an evaluation, right? Is it like, hey, like, I believe in God? Or is it, hey, I'm pursuing God? And here's maybe some things that you might be able to measure, like, if you're pursuing, right? Are you spending time in prayer, journaling? Do you cry out to him? Do you petition? Do you intercede on other people's behalf? Do you get in the scripture and read it? Do you memorize it? Do you hide in your heart? Do you wake up and put on worship music and just praise him individually or as a family? Do you go out and walk around in his creation or go for a hike and just say, wow, like, let me just reflect on your glory, God? Right? This is just an abbreviated way. There's no one way that God says, hey, this is how you have to pursue me. He's given us creativity. We know there's ways not to. And we've listed a number of ways that we just can. But I think here's the thing that I think sometimes we get caught on, okay? Does anyone ever feel like, hey, I did that a little bit and God's nowhere to be found? He's distant. Where are you, God? Read along with me. This is an illustration that God uses. When I say God, I mean Jesus, but in Luke chapter 11, verses 5 through 13, Jesus is explaining to his listeners what he wants them to understand about the character of God. Okay, so we're reading this through the lens of, God, help me understand your heart and your character. Because remember, the audience that Jesus was speaking to at this time was a super religious culture, right? All the commandments, all the thou shalt, all the thou shalt nots. And they're hyper-focused on basically all these things they should do and all these things they shouldn't do, and then they misinterpret that for relationship. And when we use this word pursue, we're pursuing like a husband or like a man would when he's courting his wife and he wants to win her heart, right? It says God pursues us and we're to pursue him in return. This is what it says in Luke chapter 11. Which of you who has a friend will go to him at midnight and say to him, friend, lend me 3 loaves. So here's the situation, right? It's the middle of the night. You're sleeping. Someone comes and knocks on the door and rattles it. You're like, what? I'm busy, right? That's the context here. For a friend of mine has arrived on a journey and I have nothing to set before him. Hey, I'm disturbing you because some guy showed up and is disturbing me. And he will answer from within, do not bother me. The door is now shut and my children are with me in bed. I cannot get up and give you anything. I tell you though, he will not get up and give him anything because he is his friend, yet because of his impudence. Okay, this is coming from a place of rudeness or like duty or obligation. He'll do it out of an obligation that's not rooted in the heart being in it. He will rise and give him whatever he needs. And I tell you, ask and it will be given to you. Seek and you will find. Knock and it will be opened to you. For everyone who asks receives, and the one who seeks finds, and to the one who knocks, it will be opened. Then Jesus asked this question. He frames it this way. What father among you, if a son asks for a fish, will instead of a fish give him a serpent? Or if he asks for an egg, will give him a scorpion? If you then, who are evil, know how to give good gifts to your children, how much more will the Heavenly Father give the Holy Spirit to those who ask him? We know that the Holy Spirit is part of the triune God, right? And he baptizes believers into Christ. We know Romans chapter 8, he works on our behalf. He even intercedes and prays for us when we don't know what to pray. We know that those that are caught in sin and don't yet know him, right? He leads them to repentance. He reveals light to people walking in darkness and truth to people walking in lies. Convicts them of their sin, John 16, 2 Corinthians 2. We all need more of God in our life and less of whatever the world has to offer in our hearts and minds. And Jesus here assures his listeners, which is also us, we're his readers, right? That if we are like the neighbor in need and we seek out God, he will give us the Holy Spirit. He will give us more of himself. We all know the passage in Jeremiah 29:11, for I know the plans I have for you, declares the Lord, right? And this is one of the most misused scriptures in all of the Bible, right? People take this to basically mean, hey, like, God's got nothing but goodness planned for me. And really, that's not the context at all. In fact, Jeremiah was prophesying, you know, to a nation that had been living in not in the Lord's ways. And he's saying, in spite of all that, God's not done with you, right? After you're in exile, I'll bring you home and we'll start over and we'll begin this relationship again. And he's talking specifically about the covenant people of Israel. Right, but read the verses before and after with me. It says, for I know the plans I have for you, declares the Lord, plans for welfare and not for evil, to give you a future and a hope. Then you will call upon me and come and pray to me and I will hear you. You will seek me and find me. And when you seek me with what? Your extra spare time? The last bit of leftovers? No, he says, when you seek me with all your heart, I will be found by you, declares the Lord, and I will restore your fortunes and gather you from among the nations and places where I've driven you, declares the Lord, and I will bring you back to the place which I sent you into exile. So this isn't a direct promise for us, but again, like just like the first passage, we can know the heart of God, right? Like he wants to be found by those that seek him earnestly. In Hebrews chapter 11, verse 6, the author says, "And without faith it is impossible to please him, for whoever would draw near to God must believe that he exists, and that he what? That he rewards those who seek him." James chapter 4, so this is the half-brother Jesus, chapter 4, verses 6 through 8, he says, "But he gives more grace, therefore it says, God opposes the proud, but gives grace to the humble. Submit yourselves, therefore, to God. Resist the devil, and he will flee from you. Draw near to God, and what? He will draw near to you. Cleanse your hands, you sinners, and purify your hearts, you double-minded," right? Basically implying that they're waffling in their faith. And he's saying, resist the devil, draw near to God, and he will be found by you. Guys, we have it so good in America. I know that a lot of us look at the news and we watch what's happening and we literally scratch our head and go, how did things start going so crazy? Anyone else ever have that thought? Right? All the time? We're like, it's still one of the most privileged places to live in all of human history. Right? And not only that, the gospel of Jesus Christ, like we have Bibles on our phones, we have them in print, we've got, like, there's no limitation of access or ways that we can pursue God here. And I think sometimes it's like we're sitting at the buffet all day long, every day, that we don't even realize what's in front of us. Right, when you point one finger, there's three pointing back at you. Right, this is true for all of us. If you want to read a really good book, one of my old pastors recommended this book to us. It's by Tom Doyle, okay? And the book is called Dreams and Visions. And it's a collection of stories of how in the Arab and Muslim world right now, there are people all over the place crying. They don't have access to Bibles. They will be persecuted if they're a Christian. And these people are crying out, God, I'm caught in this system. I see the wickedness. I see this religion. Like, if there's a one true God, please reveal yourself to me. And this book is a collection of testimonies of one after another of, even when someone isn't there to share the gospel, God is sending dreams, God is sending visions to those people that are earnestly crying and seeking out, God, reveal yourself to me. You want to be inspired, read this book. You want it to ignite your faith about pursuing God and the other things we're going to talk about? Great book. Tom Doyle, Dreams and Visions. Here's the thing. It is God's joy to be found by those that pursue him. You ever think about that? Like, we think about ourselves a lot, right? God, help me. God, I need this. God, I need that. But really, what the scriptures really teach is we were created to worship. We're created to reflect his glory back to him. We're created to bring him glory and joy and satisfaction. Not that he needs us, right? But that we're reflecting back to him his good nature. We were made to worship and adore him. But here's the thing. When we do that, when we pursue God with all our heart, with all our soul, with all our mind, and what? Our strength. It also makes deposits of joy in us. So that's point number one. I'm going to do something a little different this morning. Let's just stop and pray. I'm going to give each person just a moment to just think about this for a minute. And then we'll move on to the next point. But just take 30 seconds, 45 seconds, and just talk to God. God, you have my heart. God, help me to pursue you. God, help inspire me. Like, help me get the junk out of whatever it is. Just do business with God right now, and then we'll pray a little bit, and then we'll move on. Holy God, we just come before you as a church family, individually and collectively. And we just ask, Holy Spirit, that you would just move in our hearts in such a way where we are just desperate for you, God. Thank you that you promise to not hide yourself, but you promise to be found for those who seek you. Lord, we just went through multiple verses on this. So Lord, we in this moment, we aspire to draw near to you, Lord, and we just pray that you draw near to us. And God, I pray that every single person who's listening online, Lord, that's here, I pray this for myself and my family, God, that we would not take you for granted the way that we do sometimes. Lord, thank you so much for loving us. Thank you for being gentle with us, God. And thank you that you promise to be near to us as we seek you out, God. So we just pray in Jesus' name right now, Lord, that we would just be a church that just pursues you, not half-heartedly, Lord, but with all of our mind and soul and strength. And we lift this up in Christ's name. Amen. Okay, number one. That was number one. Number two. Something that puts deposits of joy in us is when we pursue one another. Is anyone out there selfish by nature? Right? Guys, I struggle with this all the time. Like, my natural inclination is what? It's to look after numero uno. Right? Like, that is, I think, the normal human condition. But we are assured that when we are baptized into Christ, God starts to form a new nature in us, right? And that new nature in us is the nature of God, the nature of Christ. And what did we see from Jesus, right? Jesus was regularly about the Father's business and everyone else's interest. Like, that's what he was frankly on mission here to accomplish, right? In John chapter 13, so this is that same Olivet discourse. This is what Jesus says to his disciples. He says a new commandment. This isn't a suggestion. This isn't like a life tip. He's saying, if you are one of my followers, and he's looking right at his crew there, which you guys are, we know that they all, one betrayed him and the rest of them went to the grave on account of this love. The new commandment I give you, love one another. How do we love one another? Just as I have loved you. Also, you are to love one another. By this, all people will know that you are my disciples, if you have love for one another, John 13. Here's what Jesus says. He says, I've loved you, and when somebody's experienced the love of Jesus, they will never be the same. It changes them. When the Holy Spirit connects our hearts to his, he changes us from the inside out. Anyone ever experienced that? Right? Like, as you came into Christ, he gives and births in you a new heart, new desires, all these things. But the reason we're going over this is sometimes we get a little comfortable. Sometimes we settle back in. And we're not walking in the fullness of joy that the Lord has for us. I hope Tisha doesn't mind me sharing this story, but a few weeks ago, she was down and out, hit pretty hard with COVID. Right, to the point where she's like, this isn't just like I'm taking some time off. This is like I'm struggling. And just so proud of our church here. There was a few people in the church that organized a meal train, basically to help care for them. And for those who don't know, Tisha grew up in the LDS church and has been seeking God, but it's only really recently that she came, I would say, to like a fullness of faith. Right, where she's nodding yes, right? Where she's like, oh my gosh, it's not by my works, it's by his shed blood, right? Believing the one true gospel. And as you church, as you stepped forward and you brought meals each week, that had a tremendous impact on her family, who the Lord's still working on. And her husband, Matthew, literally was looking at one after another, these people that he considers essentially mostly strangers, right? They're not family. They're not what he would consider like lifelong dear friends. And you, church, one after another, are just showing simple acts of love. And what Tisha said is perhaps there's nothing that had broke down his walls of hostility and unbelief. He's still seeking, right? He's still trying to figure it out. But that was the chink in the armor, is that he saw love demonstrated in a way that the world does not do. And it was the first thing that opened him up to, okay, well, let's have some more spiritual conversations, but not from a place of combat, but a place of curiosity. See, God's a God of love. And when he makes that deposit of love in you, he wants you and he expects for you to be an open vessel to then pour his love through and out. We're talking about the world in a little bit, but to one another. We got to start with ourselves. This is what the author of Hebrews says in chapter 10, verse 24. It says, let us consider how to stir up one another to love and good works. Is that how we spend our time, right? Like considering how can we like stir each other on to be more like Jesus and be his hands and feet. Not neglecting to meet together as some are in the habit, but encouraging one another and all the more as you see the day drawing near. Right? So in light of eternity, knowing that that's what we're really focused on, well, if that's the case, how do we use our days then to meet together, to build each other up, to encourage one another, to care for one another, right? And fulfill what Jesus had told the apostles to do, right? And really, they will know us by our love. We just went over a testimony of that. Guys, life is difficult. We meet together. I think sometimes in the American church, and I'm not putting this on you guys, sometimes in our culture, we're so misinformed that we think church is something that we attend each week. Right? It's Sunday, I'm going to church. We even talked about this in our summer series. I don't think that's how we're supposed to think about the body of Christ at all. It's Sunday, I'm gathering with my fellow believers to sharpen each other, to stir each other up, to encourage one another, to pray for one another, right? To lay hands on one another, to challenge and exhort, all these things, right? And not only that, to love one another with a holy kiss and a holy hug. Kiss on the cheek, PG version, right? Any athletes in the room? Anyone ever play sports, right? So I have found, I just, that when it comes to sports, I'm a team sports guy, okay? I played soccer. But when it comes to sports and it comes to training, I know that Sam did personal fitness training for a while. There's a truth that anyone that trains on their own, they're only going to reach such a level. But if they really want to reach the next level, even if it's an individual sport like golf or tennis or whatever, in order to get to that highest level of potential, you always do best when you've got other people around you pushing you, coaches, teammates, etc. Right? If you want to basically maximize your aptitude and your potential. And I think that in a lot of ways, we as Christians, as Americans, as the church, we're like, okay, you do you, I'll do me, right? Like we'll kind of keep this nice separation. We'll love each other from a distance. Anyway, church, I'm not here to prescribe or to lecture or to anything. I'm here to read what God's word says. And what God's word says is, hey, they will know you by your love for one another, right? We are to not forsake assembly. We are to get together and do those things. And then we see how this played out in the early church. Funny, as I read this verse, Sam is going to know. We have one guy at our church in Texas. It's like his favorite verse in the whole Bible. Acts 2:42. And it says, and they devoted themselves to the apostles' teaching and to fellowship, to the breaking of bread and the prayers. And awe came upon every soul. And many wonders and signs were being done through the apostles. And all who believed were together and had all things in common. And they were selling their possessions and belongings and distributing the proceeds to all as any had need. And day by day, attending the temple together and breaking bread in their homes, they received their food with glad and generous hearts, praising God and having favor with all the people. And the Lord added to their number day by day those that were being saved. Church, for a New Testament person, like someone that's living in, let's just say, like 35 AD, when this was happening, the ultimate sign of acceptance and fellowship was having a meal together. Like, that was like, hey, we're separate, but now we're one. But not only what's going on in this text is there was dividing walls of hostility between the different cultures. There was those that were from Jerusalem, the high and mighty city, right? Everyone else is lesser. Maybe the residents of New York City, how they view the rest of the country, right? Then you've got the rest of Judea. Oh, that's all the villagers, the rural folk. Then you've got the northern kingdom. Ah, you guys aren't really part of us anymore. I guess kind of you are by our history, but we really look at you as lessers. Then there's the Samaritans, right? You guys are like half-breeds. And then you got all the pagans and Gentiles. And what this verse is making clear to the reader is people from every one of these different ethnic and socioeconomic and whatever groups and religious backgrounds that have put their faith in Jesus are now sitting together. And there's a love that's demonstrable and visible, and it's playing out tangibly that, like, the world can't understand. It's not natural. It's supernatural because it's birthed by God's Spirit. Guys, as many of you know, this church is a Baptist church at our origins. This should be easy for us. Baptists love to eat. I remember the first time when we showed up here, they're like, we're going to throw a banquet for the new pastor, and I preached on fasting. Talk about being tone deaf, this guy, right? But modern day evangelical, we love to eat. What a great opportunity, since we all eat every single day, to get together and to fellowship and to build bridges and to love one another and care for one another. This last week on Thursday, we had a pizza party. We went over to Lucy's Pizza. Is that what it's called? Man, that was good. Jake ordered some pizza that I probably wouldn't get again, but the rest of the pizza was great. Inside joke.
Everybody has great taste.
That's true, especially not this guy, right? But that's the beauty, is we got together people from all walks of life. Some of us like good pizza, some of us don't. anyway, we hung out, about eight or nine of us, had a great time of fellowship. Guys, sometimes we got to study in the Word, and we got to go serve, and we got to reach. Sometimes we just need to get together and laugh. Just love one another. Just care for one another. Just pray for one another. Just be silly. There's a couple opportunities right now in the church, guys. We have a friend, I'm not going to mention her name, but her house has an infestation, and it needs to be treated. Got to raise about $1,500 to basically get her house taken cared for. If God's prompting your heart and you want to be a part of that, please see Greg after. You want to be a part of just helping meet that need. Also, Capri's going to kill me. She's sitting in the back. She needs to get some dental work done. It's been deferred for years. There's a couple people that have already said they're going to donate, but I just like everyone to take the invitation, whether it's $10 or $100 or $1,000, whatever God might prompt your heart. These are our church family, friends, and we want to take care, and we express our love not just in hugs and kisses, but in tangible ways. So if God prompts your heart in that, there's no pressure there, but if God prompts your heart, this is part of how we love one another. With that being said, let me just close this, and let's just take a moment and just pray, like, God, are we really walking in the love and the fullness of what you've asked of us? So just take 45 seconds or a minute and just talk to God. God, we thank you so much for rescuing us, God. We were walking in darkness, and you adopted us in as your sons and daughters, Lord, and you gave us a family that the world does not understand, but they can see the fruit and the evidence of it. when we carry this out in very spiritual but also very tangible and practical ways, God. So, Lord, I just pray for, again, each individual here and just for also our church collectively, God, that we would be a church that is marked by your love one for another. Holy Spirit, have your way in us. Just give us a deep affection. Lord, give us practical outworkings. And Lord, help us to just continue to shed off of our selfish nature, God, and make one another a priority. And we lift this all up in Christ's name. Amen. Okay, last point. Third is, if we want the fullness of joy in us, one of the things that we're called to do is we're called to pursue the lost. We talked about this in summer. We can't save anybody. Only Jesus can do that, right? That's not our responsibility at all. Our responsibility, though, is to pursue them, and specifically relationally. You know, we use this word lost, and I was thinking about it. I was like, man, like if I'm an unbeliever, that term is like kind of offensive. Right? Like, we use it so casually in Christian circles. But if I'm an unbeliever, I'm like, lost? I'm like, I'm right here. You know, well, where does that come from? Well, we read in Luke chapter 15, right? Jesus tells three parables. The first one is of the lost sheep. Second one is of the lost coin. And the third one, we call the prodigal son, but it's really the lost son, right? The son that left, and he's lost spiritually and estranged from his family. So that's not meaning to be offensive, but that's where that term really, you know, comes from biblically, is we think about the lost, and we come from Jesus' very teaching. And what Jesus says, this is the point we're parking on, right? In each one of those, when the sheep is found, Jesus asked this question in his parable, in his teaching. He says, basically, there's great rejoicing. It produces joy when that which was lost was found. And specifically, he says that in heaven there's rejoicing. Meaning Jesus believes in heaven. Right? It's not something of our imagination. Same thing with the coin. And then we see in the third one, the prodigal son, which is, the prodigal means like extravagant living. And then not only does he extravagantly rebel, the father extravagantly welcomes him back home with this act of great mercy and grace that is completely unwarranted based on his behavior. And the father says, right, I'm throwing this party because my son that was lost has come home. He's found. The Bible teaches everywhere that those who don't know God through a personal faith in Jesus Christ are lost. They may be physically present, but they're spiritually lost. And that doesn't even mean that they're not pursuing a good moral life, a career, a family, right? It just means that if they don't have a saving faith in Jesus Christ, they've responded to the invitation to be forgiven of their sins by the shed blood of Jesus and his resurrection, right? Even if everything on paper looks good, they're still a lost coin. They're still a prodigal son. They're still just a sheep that needs rescuing, as were each of us, right? Listen to this passage. So this is Paul writing to Timothy in chapter 2, verses 1 through 6. This is what Paul says. He says, first of all then, I urge, he's talking to the church in Ephesus, and it's like main pastor, Timothy. He says, I urge that supplications and prayers and intercessions and thanksgiving be made for all people, for kings and for those that are in high positions, that we may lead peaceful and quiet lives, godly and dignified in every way. And this is good, and it is pleasing in the sight of our God and Savior, who desires all people to be saved and to come to the knowledge of truth. For there is one God, and there is one mediator between God and men, the man Christ Jesus, who gave himself as a ransom for all, which is the testimony given at the proper time. I don't know why I feel like God like, this is one of the questions I'm going to ask in the future. Like, why did you ask us to do what you could probably do better? Right, God, you can give dreams and visions. We just referenced a book where there's people in, you know, behind curtains spiritually that you reach out to. Like, why did you choose to go through broken and fearful and insecure vessels like us? I don't have the answer to that necessarily, right? But God did not leave us here to build up our 401ks. That's not the pursuit of life, no matter how much culture tells us it is. Notice what Paul says is the starting point, as God wishes that all would come to a saving faith, right, by the Spirit of God and the knowledge of truth, is he starts with prayer. He says supplications and prayers and intercessions. And there's prayer for those that are high and mighty in our culture. We might call them the elites, right? So it's people that push their agenda on us. Pray for them. I get angry more often than I pray for them, right? If I want the joy of the Lord, I need to spend less time angry at them and more time praying for them. Amen? But what about my neighbor that's walking in darkness, that's technically lost? He's walking in, right? Paul says, pray for him. Notice how God desires that all would be unlost. Is that even a word? Right? That they would be not lost. Notice how Paul also says there's only one way to become unlost. It's through the blood of Jesus and the payment on our behalf. He's the one mediator. Romans chapter 10 says, but what does it say? The word is near you, in your mouth and in your heart. That is the word of faith that we proclaim. Because if you confess with your mouth that Jesus is Lord and believe in your heart that God raised him from the dead, you'll be saved. Pretty simple formula. I don't got to say 17 Hail Marys, right? I don't need to wear special garments, right? Is any of that anywhere? No, it says I need to confess with my mouth that Jesus is Lord. Transfer my trust into him. That's all the lost need to do. For with the heart one believes and is justified, and with the mouth one confesses and is saved. For the scripture says that everyone who believes in him will not be put to shame. For there is no distinction between Jew and Greek, for the same Lord is Lord of all, bestowing his riches in all who call on him. For everyone who calls on the name of the Lord will be saved. How then will they call on him in whom they have not believed? And how are they to believe of him if they have never heard? And how are they to hear without someone preaching, sharing, right? And how are they to preach unless they are sent? As it is written, how beautiful are the feet of those who preach the good news. Church, we want to walk in the fullness of joy. There is probably very few things that are as exhilarating as watching the Lord open and change and break off the chains of sin and walk them from darkness into light. I guarantee every one of us wants to be a part of God doing that in people's lives. That brings him great joy to set people free and to save them. And it brings us great joy to participate in what he's doing in their hearts. But we go back. It actually begins with prayer, right? And this may be an inventory question, right? Does everyone have a prayer list? People that you're specifically praying for, that you would see God move and that you'd make yourself available to be used by him in their lives. All of us have neighbors, all of us have coworkers, right? Doesn't mean he's necessarily going to answer, but I'll tell you what, God likes to show up with those who seek him earnestly. I've seen it over and over. In Mark chapter 16, it says that Jesus instructed his disciples, go into all the world and proclaim the gospel to whole creation. Whoever believes and is baptized will be saved, and whoever does not will be condemned. Uh-oh. I was trying to think about the last time that I heard a message from a preacher or a pastor or a podcast that talked about hell. I feel like hell has been largely erased in just normal everyday dialogue. But Jesus says right here that those who don't believe will be condemned. Most people don't want to be condemned, friends. They just don't want to come under the authority of God. Right? They don't want to surrender, but they don't want to be condemned. And ever see the movie The Matrix? There's this conversation where Neo is sitting there with Morpheus, and this dialogue goes back and forth. And Neo is asked this question by Morpheus, and he responds with, I don't like the idea that I'm not in control of my life. And really, like, that is the issue so often with what prohibits people from coming to a saving faith, is they don't like the idea. They want to be God. They want to be in control. They want to, you know, control their own fate. And I think that sometimes we're such respecters, as is God, of what those people want, that it takes away our urgency. It takes away our concern. And I'm speaking on behalf of myself. If this registers with you, maybe I'm just preaching to me. Okay? What's interesting, I'm in an apologetics class right now. We're going to wrap up in just 3 or 4 or 5 minutes here, guys. And there's a book that I'm reading. It's called If God, Why Evil? And it's answering, like, basically a lot of kind of theological, philosophical questions that unbelievers have, right? Like stumbling blocks of why I can't put my faith in God. And one of them is people do not like the idea of hell. And what's interesting is how language is so powerful and things get framed. And I'm gonna give the stat and then I'm gonna give the framing, okay? So the statistic in America is that somewhere north of 80% of people believe in heaven. The other part of the coin is that something like less than 30% of people believe in hell. You ever like talk to a dog and it does the, right? Like that doesn't make any sense. It doesn't add up at all. And the reason is because we have a propensity as humans to, it offends us. But it goes back to the framing. What is the framing of what hell is? The framing of hell is that it's a place of eternal torture. And a good and loving God would never torture anybody. Well, that's a misdiagnosis of the situation. Torture means I did something, right? I'm put in a situation where I didn't actually choose to be receiving what I'm getting. Said another way, torture is I have a will that is inflicted on me that is not in alignment with what I chose. Bible doesn't ever describe hell as torture, but it does describe it as torment. And torment, we can put ourselves in situations of torment all the time. We do things, we make decisions, right? That things that basically come back to haunt us, things that have consequences. So going on to that, right? 80% believe in heaven, 30% hell. But the reason is God's good, so therefore we must be misreading this all. But it's as if people are interpreting, well, God sent me there rather than like I actually chose not to come into a relationship with God. I chose not to surrender. I like the idea of being in control of my life. So in this book, I'm going to rattle off a few things and we'll wrap up, guys. Jesus warned, do not be afraid of those who kill the body but cannot kill the soul. Rather, be afraid of the one that can destroy both soul and body in hell. That's Matthew chapter 10, verses 28. It says, fear God, right? Eternal separation. He added, those who reject him, as the weeds are pulled up and burned in the fire, so will it be at the end of the age. In his Mount Olivet discourse, the Lord declared, then he will say to those on his left, depart from me, you who are cursed, into the eternal fire prepared for the devil and his angels. That's Matthew 25:41. Mark 9:43. If your hand causes you to sin, cut it off, for it is better to enter life maimed than go through with two hands into hell, where the fire never goes out. In the book of Revelation, the Apostle John sees a vision, and this is what it says. It says, the dead were judged according to what they had done as recorded in the books. The sea gave up the dead that were in it, and the death and Hades gave up the dead that were in them. And each person was judged according to what he'd done. Then death and Hades were thrown into the lake of fire, and the lake of fire is the second death. If anyone's name was not found written in the book of life, he was thrown into the lake of fire. Jesus talked, the New Testament talks about hell and eternal separation more than ever talks about heaven. So why do I go down this road, right? Well, we just started. If we want to be full of joy, right, God, we just read this. God wants He desires that none would be lost, right? That all would be saved, that all would come to him. And for whatever reason, he's chose us. 2 Thessalonians verses 1 through 7, this is what it says. This will happen when the Lord Jesus is revealed from heaven in blazing fire with his powerful angels. He will punish those who do not know God and do not obey the gospel of our Lord Jesus. They will be punished with everlasting destruction and shut out from the presence of the Lord and from the majesty of his power. People are perishing apart from Jesus Christ. Here's the great thing about this. If we are wrong, if the Bible is untrue in what I'm saying to you right now, did we really lose anything? All of the statistics show that people that are like in like an actual authentic Christian faith, not just, you know, a Christian in name only, right? They have more joy, they have more peace, they have more fulfillment, they got better relationships, all those things. So at a minimum, the Bible is full of wisdom that helps people like actually live more contented and fulfilling lives. But what if they're wrong? Right, it's eternal separation. Guys, we wish that on nobody. Peter, 2 Peter verses 3, 8, 9 says this, but do not overlook this one fact, beloved, that with the Lord one day is 1,000 years, and as 1,000 years is 1 day. The Lord is not slow to fulfill his promise, as some count slowness. Basically, he's giving people a chance. But is patient toward you, not wishing that any should perish, but that all should reach repentance. So, recapping this point, guys. Now this is kind of like depressing and heavy, right? But I found, right, like we get so distracted, myself. And if we want to walk in the fullness of the joy that the Lord has for us, right, the greatest thing of excitement that the believer can actually experience is when they see the Lord help someone become unlost. Not another thing you do in this life will bring you more joy and satisfaction than to see someone regenerated in Christ. And so the question is, like, are we pursuing the lost so that we get to participate in this rescue mission that God has? And if not, then we got to ask ourselves, well, why not? Am I simply too busy? Is it not a priority? Do I not understand the consequences? Like, what is it that has me distracted from that which is so important to the heart of God, that people would leave the 99 to go get the one, just like Christ did? So Tanner, if you would, just come on up. We're going to close up here. But Jesus promised, right? We started at the very beginning, that those who seek him will find him. And so I just want to close this out in kind of the same way we did before, and give each of you the opportunity, just let the Holy Spirit draw to your mind just a handful of people that you know, that he would just impress on your heart, that you could just say, Lord, here I am, send me, right? You care about their soul more than I do. You care about the eternity. Lord, break my heart for their condition. Lord, use me to be your hands and feet, and let them see your love through me. Would you take a moment and just pray to God personally about that? Father in heaven, if there is any person in this room right now, they have just learned, that anyone that doesn't know you, God, they've just seen clearly from your word, Lord, that you will be found by anyone that seeks you earnestly. You promise it. Lord, this congregation is a fellowship and a testimony to the love that you have for us and that we have for one another. God, even just reading through those passages, God, even in preparation for this sermon, like I'm more disturbed now than I was during the prep, God, just the magnitude of eternal separation and what that means. So God, if there is any person here that does not have a relationship with you through Jesus, Lord, I pray that they would be just made crystal clear aware of that right now in this moment. And they would just cry out to you, and they'd come speak to Sam or myself after the service and just say, I need Jesus. So we make ourselves available for that. Lord, for the rest of us, may we pursue you. May we chase after you. May we long for you. Cast aside all of the other idols that get in our way. Lord, may we love one another the way you've called us to and the way that you've loved us. And God, as the song says, may you break our hearts for what breaks yours. And Lord, there are people all around us that are perishing. They are lost. Lord, give us the mind share. Give us the sensitivity to your spirit. Lord, give us the heart to pursue them. And Lord, thank you that it's not up to us. Your Holy Spirit promises that you will give us the words at the right time as a testimony to those that you are drawing to yourself, God. But we make ourselves available, Lord. And I just pray for every person's congregation right now, Lord. I pray that they would get to experience the joy that is so immense of being a part of you drawing someone to yourself and saving them for eternity. Lord, may we have testimony after testimony of your goodness in that space. All our hope is in you, and none of it is in ourselves. Thank you for this morning, Jesus. It's in your name we pray. Amen.
doesn't stand a chance when I stand in your love. My fear doesn't stand a chance when I stand in your love. My fear doesn't stand a chance when I stand in your love. Shame no longer has a place to hide. I am not a captive to the light. I'm not afraid to leave my past behind.
could imagine so great a mercy.
Hallelujah.